What's up, Chicago? It's your boy, your host, Pastor Daniel LP. We are live in the studio, and taking this off is on the air, live from the West Side Studios, located on the third floor of Kingdom Missionary Baptist Church. We have an amazing show for you guys today. We'll bring this brother on in about a good 5 minutes or so. He's going to be here for the entire day. Pastor Micheal B Henderson, the good bishop, cardinal, His Eminence, is in the studio with us today. Yeah, I set it up. He's in the studio with us today, so we're going to see what we can glean from him and his information, what's going on down at the Second Baptist Church of the Branch. Down in the Branch, man, I have no idea. Right around the corner from you. Right around the corner from you. Not in the Branch. So we definitely going to enjoy him. As always, in the studio with me, my partner, Crown, how are you, sir?
Good. How's it going?
Man, I'm blessed. Blessed and highly favored. Yeah, sorry. Yeah, I'm good. Good. Everything is good. It's hot. It is real hot. We got this fan. This fan. Please tell me if y'all can hear this fan running in the background. Otherwise, I'm going to cut it off. But that fan is real loud. Real loud. So, good fan. That's low. I know. So, if you can hear the fan, then we're going to cut it off. But anyway, we're going to work with it. We have a great show for you guys today, and hopefully you'll get some good information with that. Let me give you a rundown on how you can contact the show. If you're already listening via your cell phone, via your device, if you called in, you can just push one, and you can be a part of the show with your questions or your comments. If you're listening via Blog Talk Radio, that's our home base, simply dial 855-381-8804. That's 855-381-8804. And you, too, can be a part of the show. We're all over social media. You want to hit us on social media. We're on Facebook
page. And go to find us at Taking the Limits Off with Dana and Devon. And we will be right there for you. Also, we're on Twitter. We're all over the Twitterverse. And just simply go there, find our information. It is at TTLO Radio. That's at TTLO Radio. You can hit us there. And if you have something to say that requires more than 140 characters, guess what? You can email the show, and that is at takingthelimitsoff@comcast.net. takingthelimitsoff@comcast.net. And we are live on Ustream right now. What's up to the people? How are you? Yeah, that's us. We sitting here trying not to sweat, but we here in the studio. And last but not least, guess what? Y'all know the news. We're on iTunes. You can subscribe to our podcast immediately after the show is over. The show is available on iTunes. Just simply go there, search for Taking the Limits Off with Dana and Devon, and you can subscribe to our podcast. And I did give you the Ustream channel. It's Taking the Limits Off with Dana and Devon as well. And just click the live link. Man.
It's a lot of information.
You think?
Well, at least you're able to connect some way.
Man.
You was able to hear something where you could.
Man. Oh, I forgot one. You know we're on Instagram now. We're on the gram.
Here we go.
We're on the Insta. Hey, look.
Here we go. With
they said we got to be where the people at, right? didn't we say this? Go where the people at? That's where we go, right? So we're on Instagram. They want us to get on Snapchat, but I don't know how to work it. That's beyond my realm.
Those are like second clips or something like that.
It's right? Like you do some kind of digital storytelling or whatever. Okay. Sharice's daughter is like really good at it, so maybe we had to get her in here. You know, we had her on when we did the youth thing. Maybe we gotta give us a Snapchat lesson.
Okay.
All right, we can.
We get that together.
Yeah, because I'm a little lost on that one. I installed it on my phone, but don't know what to do, so I'm good on that. Look here, y'all. We have a good, like I said, we have Pastor Micheal Henderson with us. He'll be joining us shortly. Just want to go over some stuff with you. So I see your boy, Tom Brady.
It is true.
I know y'all said this is a Christian allegedly show, but I got to go in real quick. Your boy.
Not my boy.
I know. I just thought I'd throw it out there. Your boy, Tom, they upheld the suspension. Folks, still getting them four games, huh?
Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. Well. Yeah.
It's interesting that people may not say that it should be talked about on such a major scale or even considered.
Uh-huh.
Here it is. You guys are willing to take a little league a trophy from a group of kids, and you said it was cheating.
Ah.
And so here it is in the NFL. Mm-hmm. These people have turned around and found out that not only has his coach had inside dealings when they stole information in previous times, but there is more cheating going on in the NFL, and nobody's being stripped of anything.
Mm.
The double standard still exists.
Mm.
You strip these kids of their winnings.
Yes.
So the winnings and the trophy go, right?
Yeah, they did.
Okay. So the Patriots win the Super Bowl.
Yes.
We find out that they were cheating in the process.
Yes.
You still let them keep the Super Bowl championship with the ring and all of that stuff. Come on, somebody need to help me out with that.
Well, they here's the thing. And I'm gonna leave it alone. The balls, whether they were deflated or not, I don't even think that's the issue. And what this is what I'll have to agree with who I normally don't agree with, Stephen A. Smith, on this particular issue. He said that at this point it ain't even about the cheating, because the way Roger Goodell works is if he finds that you lied to him, then you get the boot. You get hit hard. You know, you think back to like with Michael Vick and the dog fighting. Most of Michael Vick's punishment didn't come from just killing the dogs. It was because he looked the commissioner in the face and lied and said, "Hey man, I ain't got nothing to do with this." And then they start digging up dogs on your front yard. It's a little bogus at that point. But in this case, he said he had nothing to do with the balls being deflated. But here's the part that people keep missing. Why did you suspend the two equipment managers then, Patriots, if there was nothing wrong? Nobody, they keep saying, nobody in our organization did anything wrong. Then why were the two, the ball boy and the equipment, why were they suspended from the team? And they still away from the team. Okay, that's all right. We gone.
So
I know we don't normally talk sports. I know people are like, why are they talking about sports?
So my point is the double standard.
Exactly.
The double standard. Here it is. You strip Barry Bonds.
Where did they strip? Well. He's still a home run king.
But you didn't strip Mark McGwire.
They're not letting nobody go to the Hall of Fame though. Neither
so,
one.
So, it is. Ultimately, it's sad, and it shows that how much more we need God in every aspect of life.
True.
Not just what we would consider the Christian arena, but the Christian values and those core values from the Bible need to be operated outside of the church in our everyday lives. When we govern in any area, from systems to governments, this is why God is a just God.
Come on.
And we have to depend on him even when everything else fails.
Come on, sir.
What I mean? It's crazy how we live in a world where the standards, there is a double standard. And it's a double standard based on who you are.
Mm.
And so this is the part where we say, look, okay, well, it wasn't that big of a deal. It had to be a big deal that you were stripped the Little League team of that trophy.
Well,
because somebody blew the whistle. So somebody figured out and blew the whistle on this Tom Brady situation. Mm-hmm. And the only thing that he's going to get is a 4-game suspension. The team gets to keep a trophy.
Well, they got a 4-game suspension. They got $1 million fine, which is the highest fine that they could get. And then they lost 2 draft picks. The team did. For this year, this year's draft pick and next year's draft pick. Whatever they get.
When has it ever been okay for you to hold on to something you cheated to get?
Well, it wasn't the Super Bowl game they cheated.
I'm just asking.
I'm
just asking. When has it ever been okay for you to still be given credit for something you cheated on?
Okay. I hear you.
That's still a slap on the wrist, because at the end of the day, I can still raise my finger. I still got the ring and the trophy.
But you know what?
How you like me now?
And just because they do walk around with the ring and the trophy, they're still thought of as cheaters, even from the Spygate situation. I know what you say.
Strip it.
But they're still going to be thought of as cheaters. Everybody, even before Spygate, in the Snow Bowl, when Brady was sacked. And the ball was a clear fumble.
Clear
fumble. And, so anyway, enough of the sports stuff. Back on this, the young lady who was killed in Texas real quick. Mm-hmm. I always screw up her last name. First name is Sandra, but it was her last
Bland.
Name. Bland. Mm-hmm. So apparently more video has been released. I don't know if you saw this one. You
remember? I didn't see it.
So there was some debate about whether or not the pictures that she that was taken of her in the orange uniform. Mm-hmm. I don't know if you, because I know you've been away from social media for a while, but there was some debate about whether or not she was dead in that picture, because her eyes were kind of rolled back in the back of her head.
Wow.
And they kind of thought that that maybe she was dead in the picture.
Mm.
Well, conveniently now, the police have released video footage of her in the uniform
mm-hmm.
posing for her mugshot.
Good.
So that clears up that part of
assumption,
it.
Yeah.
Yeah, but because people were like, you know, thinking like, because they were saying her face looked like it was pushed back and all this other stuff, and you know, so I'm wondering where she might have where that came from all of a sudden, because now, like, why is all these videos, little bits and pieces, being released? This is video that you clearly have,
mm-hmm.
so. This is a video that you clearly have, and it's like, why don't you release it all? That way, you don't look like you're trying to hide anything
mm-hmm.
from the police standpoint.
Right.
Release it all. That way, you say, you know what? Look, this woman, we don't know what happened. If that's your story, then we don't know what happened when she was locked in the cell, then stick to that particular story. But, mm-hmm. yeah, but now they're releasing this clip, and but they do, on part of the clip, show her making – she made 21 minutes worth of phone calls mm-hmm. with the orange jumpsuit on.
Mm-hmm.
And she says in one of the calls that she had been roughed up mm-hmm. pretty bad. That's her voice you hear on the message. So you definitely want to make sure that, you know, that there's no you know, weird stuff that was going on. Mm-hmm. Okay.
Foul play, yeah.
Yeah. Exactly. Exactly. Mm-hmm. So.
Wow. Yeah. I don't know why they and they tend to do that, and I think that's to draw the crowd and get the news and get the turnout, and it's another play on people's emotions, and mm-hmm. it makes for a great story. So we gotta do things to build up the story. So this is going to be an ongoing situation,
mm-hmm.
and it's like what I said on Monday.
Mm-hmm.
Did you notice that there were people out protesting?
Yeah,
even though the mom said
right,
she didn't want any protesting until they figured out.
Uh-huh.
What the truth, or she got the whole story during the funeral.
Ah, okay.
Don't protest. Don't do nothing. I'm not acting the fool. I'm not falling out.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm going to need y'all to do the same thing. So I talked to someone who attended the funeral.
Okay.
And they said the mom was saying, let's just be cool. Let me find out all that I need to find out first.
Mm-hmm.
But in the meantime, I'm going to get back together, and I'm going to talk to CNN and everybody else come Monday.
Mm.
So it's like what I said. It's no different. If you put... You ever seen clips on YouTube of a cat when they feel like they're being threatened?
Yes, yes.
The back raise up.
Yes, yes,
yes. And they start making these weird sounds.
Yes.
And they're usually backed off into a corner.
That's true.
And what they're in their fighting stance.
Mm-hmm.
So at this point, I think that, and I think it's safe to say this, that Black America is at the point where they're willing to fight.
Ah, okay.
And I can say that, and it's like people are getting fed up, and it only continues to grow this level of bitterness and anger amongst people,
mm-hmm.
our people.
Mm-hmm.
And so now you have to deal with whatever is outside of the rules.
Mm.
We're not operating in rules if you guys aren't operating in rules. And it's foolish for people to somehow believe that these people should act logical when nobody else is acting logical. Okay, I'm done. We going on to the next level. Done.
Hey, again, we just gonna keep our eyes on it, man, and see what goes on with it, because it obviously it's some craziness in Texas, and you know it is Texas. I'm gonna leave it at that. It's Texas, and that part. And you know what's interesting? I don't know if you saw the sheriff. The sheriff was on for the guy who runs. He goes, "There's no racism in Texas." Not in my county. That's what he said.
Not in your county.
Not in my county, he said. That's what he said. I found that interesting.
Wow. What county is that?
I know, right?
Oh, because we ain't going to pull up the reports.
Right, exactly.
And is he just saying since he arrived? that he has ultimately terminated all levels of racism.
I don't know what he meant.
This guy. And what's crazy is he know it ain't true. But he going to stand up there to save face.
Oh, Lord. Hey, look here, y'all. We're going to take a quick break. And when we return, we're going to have our special guest in the studio. He'll be sitting right here next to us, Pastor Micheal Henderson. We're going to leave y'all with a little bit of this. Let me get the name right. It's Moret Brown Clark. I gave the name of the song to somebody else. But it's I Just Want to Praise You. We'll be right back, y'all. TTLO. All right, that was a little bit. Let me get the name right. Moret Brown Clark. We were listening to that. Just want to praise you. Just want to praise you. Ain't nothing wrong with giving them a little praise. Amen. Amen. Look here. Look here. In the studio with us right now, as this song just continues to play, even though I hit stop. Okay. Computer do what they want to do sometimes. In the studio with us on today is met this gentleman via Facebook. He has these clips, and I'm going to tell y'all, sometimes technology do what it want to do. I had loaded one clip, and it would not play, and it's probably for the best, because I probably would have laughed and hurt myself. So I'm just going. Anyway, there is this. I met him via Facebook. He's on there. He posts these videos, and you guys know we had Darius Cooks on the show some time back in, I think it was April, I believe it was. We had him on the show via phone because of his videos. That's how we got him on the show. And one of the things was, I love people who can have fun with gospel, who can have fun with church, because a lot of times I think we, in the church, we take ourselves far too seriously. So I want to read something to you real quick. It says, Reverend Micheal B. Henderson is the proud pastor of Second Baptist Church in LaGrange, Illinois. Yeah. Previously, he resided in Greenwood, South Carolina, and was the senior pastor of the Bethlehem Grove Baptist Church of Clinton, South Carolina, where he served for over 7 years. Reverend Henderson has pastored churches in both Mississippi and South Carolina. He also serves as the director of music ministry for many churches in the Atlanta area. In addition to his pastoral duties, Reverend Henderson currently serves as the chairperson for the late night services for South Carolina E&M Convention. Was that convection? I think she meant convention. Hey, convention okay. And okay. State Congress, as well as, I'm going to get in trouble for reading it that way. He read everything on the air, as well as one of the instructors. Reverend Henderson has a deep passion for Christian education and a hunger for saving souls. He's a graduate of Rust College in Holy Springs, Mississippi. Or Holly Spring.
There you go.
It ain't holy?
No, it ain't holy.
Okay. Holly Springs, Mississippi. Mississippi. Y'all see, I got country. I didn't even say Mississippi. Mississippi.
Yeah.
Where he received a Bachelor's of Arts in Social Science and Gammon Theological Seminary, ITC in Atlanta, GA, where he received a Master's of Divinity. Along with his earned degrees, he also has an honorary doctorate from Tennessee School of Religion. I ain't gonna read, let's see here. Personally, Reverend Henderson believes that there's no better business than the saving the soul business. To many, he's pastor, preacher, teacher, and leader, but to his church, he's a friend to all who never meets a stranger. With more than a decade of teaching and counseling, it has enabled him to reach others with humor, warmth, transparency, and above all, faith. Ladies and gentlemen, without further ado, we give you a pastor, bishop, his eminence, Micheal B. Henderson. Let's give him a round of applause. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Amen. Amen.
Great.
Amen.
Wonderful.
Amen. Hey, man, that was a little low. Let me try it again. All right, that was a little better. All right.
That's the mice clapping. Thank
yeah,
you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
You are mice.
Yeah. Yeah,
you might have to grab this right here.
Yeah, you hold it like a preacher.
You knew. Yes, Lord. All right, I'm going to behave. Good morning, everybody.
It works?
Yeah, it works.
You hear yourself?
I hear myself.
Okay, all right.
Oh, wow.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
So,
praise the Lord, everybody.
Lord, help us. Help us get through this.
Jesus.
Yes, man. So look here, man. I'm not even going. I'm going to save the prayers that you've been posting first. I'm going to deal with serious you for a minute.
Sure.
Because then I ain't going to be no good. So you just recently got the assignment to come back to Illinois.
Yes, I did. And let me say this as I always start. I am a avid Father Hayes fan. So follow peace with all mankind. Holiness without no man shall see the Lord. Change your attitude and your way of thinking. You change your entire life. It's been a good day. I thank God for it. I have my health and my strength, and I know I'm his child. God bless you, my father's cheering. Yes, I am a proud, proud West Sider.
Oh, okay.
I make no... no exceptions for that. I graduated from Faraday Elementary School on the West Side, and I am a wonderful, proud to be Commando for Life. Marshall High School, graduated in 1993. It's the best school on the West Side. Don't say nothing wrong, because I get y'all all in here.
Austin in the house.
That's right down the street from this here church. That's the only reason he went there, is right down the street. Anyway, anywho, listen.
I was scared to go to Marshall.
You know, the peepers. The peepers, you know, okay. You know what I'm saying? We're all scared right. to come on this side of town. Anywho, I left here in 1993.
Okay.
And I went to Rust. I attended Rust College in Mississippi. I loved it. I enjoyed it. Lived there, taught school there, pastored there. and went on to Atlanta for 3 years and been in South Carolina. So I've been here since the 1st of June.
Yeah. So what you were at, how was the transition? Because you were a pastor of a church in South Carolina.
I was pastor of a church in South Carolina. How was the transition?
Yeah.
I'm still doing it.
Oh, okay.
Pray my friend the Lord, I'll be the one he calling for.
Yeah, because I saw you were just back down there.
I was there for revival.
Okay.
Moving back home, reality has not hit me yet. But I declare it's going to hit me around October, children.
Okay.
When it get cold. Oh. Huh? Ain't nobody saying amen to me in this room. Cheering? This is the coldest place in the world.
Only second to Alaska.
But listen, bone chilling the cold. Y'all remember, don't you?
Yeah, it wasn't that long ago for us.
Yeah, not too many days hence.
Yeah, just about a week ago.
Oh yeah, this week ago. Really, really to tell the truth, shame the devil say in church.
So what happens with your with your previous church? Well, how are they?
They're looking for a pastor. Yeah, anybody want to go? 1952 Cleveland.
My brother over here.
You want to go? I'll send you down there.
I'm just saying.
Yeah, I'll be glad to send you down there.
It is South Carolina, though.
It is South Carolina.
Oh, man, it is warm climate, huh?
No,
it's warm climate.
But it's South Carolina.
Y'all going to stop that about that flag foolishness.
What? Y'all did just take the flag down.
Hey, I just work here.
I'm just saying.
Hey, just work here.
Okay. You didn't have a flag out.
That's my granddaddy. Anyway, it's South Carolina. Uh-huh. It's I enjoyed South Carolina. I really did. I have no complaints about South Carolina.
Okay.
Everywhere is racist. Now, I don't know how old you all are. And probably you won't tell your age.
Yeah. Ages. No, I'm 45.
Okay.
Probably still the 36. Oldest person in the room.
You're 36. Okay, then. Well, you're 45. I remember when we could not
about this.
Caught. No, I'm 40. Hey, I'll be 41 in November. That means.
Still upset.
You know, pray Lord. I can't help it. I remember when we couldn't go in Bridgeport. You remember that?
Yeah, but I couldn't when I was in high school. Yeah, I remember that.
And listen,
Cicero either.
Let's just tell the truth. Cicero, and we could not go. Now, I know you all forgive me that. I remember when there was no colored folk so much in Bellwood.
Yeah.
Huh?
Yeah. Come on.
Now,
yeah.
I know.
Maywood was the stopping point.
Oh, yeah, Maywood was the stopping point. Yeah. Listen, we skipped over Oak Park. Why don't y'all say amen in here? We skipped over Oak Park.
Okay.
And we went to the Maywoods. Yeah.
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 Okay, so your church is looking for a pastor. No, I'm not. I'm not interested in
I'll sing you. I'll be glad to sing you.
My brother might be, though, but I think he in the process of getting a new assignment, so he ain't.
We'll talk later on here.
Yeah, we all
right. Definitely.
Yeah, we'll talk later on.
He like going on the road. I'm good.
Yeah,
I'm kind of
a man traveling.
Yeah. Oh, okay. It's good for you.
So tell us about Second Baptist.
Second Baptist is a church that's like many churches that's going in transition now. It's a traditional church that's in transition. Mm-hmm. Good church, good people. All of the churches now are in the transition because we're trying our best to reach the millennial group.
Mm.
And that is, just put it this way, it's 12 million of us, those of our age group. It's 12 uh-huh. million of us.
Uh-huh.
And we are more spiritual than uh-huh. we are religious. But it's 80 million of the millennial group.
Wow.
They don't want to be in church all day. Mm. They may come to Bible class. They may come to church school. But they don't want to be there all day.
Right.
They want good preaching, good teaching.
Mm-hmm.
And some of them, in the words of Vashti McKenzie, they don't want to be delivered from their sins, but they want to be delivered with their sins.
Ooh.
Uh-huh. We'll talk about that later on in the sermon.
What?
Praise the Lord, everybody. Yeah.
Wow.
And so what we're trying to do is, because most of us that have been in church, we suffer from nostalgia, especially here in Chicago, because we are a church city.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, this is church right here. I mean, this is big church.
Mm-hmm.
And I suffer from what church used to be.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a group that don't know what church used to be.
Mm-hmm.
And so we're trying to get them incorporated in church. And there's nothing wrong with tradition. Everyone has to have a base.
Yes.
But we cannot be so traditional that we just X everybody out.
Wow. Again, we're talking with Pastor Micheal Henderson from Second Baptist Church out in LaGrange. Those of you who are already listening on the line, if you want to push one, may have a question or something for him, you feel free to do that. If you're listening via Facebook or Twitter or whatever, you know what to do. Send us a message. We'll gladly correspond with you. So you moved here. Did you have to bring family with you, or you came by yourself?
Nobody but me and my God and I. Praise the Lord. No, ain't nobody but me and Jesus.
Okay, all right. We're going to
and my father with two, praise the Lord.
All right. So what's the demographic of the Second Baptist Church?
Second Baptist is very interesting.
Because it's in LaGrange. That's why I asked.
It's in LaGrange, number one. First of all, can I just be honest with you all?
No, go ahead.
I didn't know that African-American, Black, Negro, color folk lived in LaGrange.
This one.
You're an exception. You're a transplant.
I've been here since 04. Seriously.
Well, see, listen, when we used to go to Brookville Zoo, y'all, the only thing we saw was a little nice Caucasian ladies and them dogs.
That's true.
You know what I'm saying? We didn't know We didn't know that the African-American, Black, Negro, color folk lived out there. And so I didn't know that that Black people lived in LaGrange, really.
That's true.
And believe it or not, they are concentrated within a 4-block radius.
Okay.
It's very interesting how it is.
Okay. Wow.
And I have a lot of people that drive in.
Mm-hmm.
And the demographics of the church is, of course, the majority of the church, maybe to say 75% are my parents' age or old enough to be my parents.
Wow.
Hey, mama.
Okay.
Now, think about this now, because I'm 41 and my mom just turned 56. So she was very young when she had me.
Mm.
But if you are between 56 and 60, you know, you're old enough to be my parents.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So getting that group is great. They are the foundation. But getting our age group
to come
has been a big demographic, which, and I know that longevity has its place. Marvin Wiley has been successful in Maywood because of his longevity, and not only that, his appealing to all audiences.
Yes.
So that has been a thing, and because I'm new, and I'm going to say this on the ether wave, if you will, I'm very amazed at, and I know it was happening when I was younger, and maybe you all can help me with this, at the cliquishness, if you will, of the preacher. And I wanted to let preachers know, I don't want no position. I'm fine. Let me pass to my people. That's where I am in my life.
Okay.
I did all of that in South Carolina. When it comes to friendliness, yeah, that's a whole other different story. But anyway, we'll talk about that at the next sermon. But Second Baptist has the potential of being the church of LaGrange. It really kind of is the church. It's just getting the stigma, because when you hear Second Baptist, you think, all right, this is the, for lack of a better term, the uppity Negro church. this is the uppity All right, I don't know why y'all laughing, because Kingdom was the uppity Negro church when we were growing up. Anyway, that's the story.
We're going to have to talk about that, because when I walked him through, just every time we have guests, I always like to show off the church's sanctuary. So I walked them through the sanctuary, and the first thing he said was, "Ooh, it's been a long time since I've been here." And I was like, "You were here, like physically in here? But if you were here back in the 90s, that's when I was on my
sabbatical.
Sabbatical.
Yeah,
right. Yeah, I was on sabbatical from 86 to 98. So.
Well, God bless you tonight. Yeah. But we knew that Kingdom, no offense.
Uh-huh.
Christ T, no offense.
Ooh.
Ooh. Reverend Bronson, you do. Uh-huh. And Central over on Walnut and Kedzie.
Uh-huh.
These were, it's a couple of more. These were.
You talking about Central Memorial?
Yes, Lord Jesus. Mm. Where my teacher with Mr. George Crocker, God rest his soul. And a couple of Union over on Damon, the big church on the corner. Mm. These were.
First Baptist. That's not, you're talking about
that. Oh, First Baptist Congregational. I cannot leave them out.
Yeah,
First Baptist Institutional. Can't leave them out. listen now, children. These were where your teachers were, your principals. I'm sorry. I'm leaving out the historic African Hut friendship on Laramie and Jackson. Mm. Praise the Lord. You know, these were the churches wherein with. You know, we were going to get him to death. You had a him in here, him over here, him.
Yes.
And these were the quieter churches. Mm. They really, really were. And so coming back here, when I hear Second Baptist, I think this is not so much the way it should be. This is the place where everything should happen.
Mm-hmm.
And so and some people still have that stigma of certain churches.
Mm-hmm.
And just want them to know that we are inviting church. We are a community church. Mm-hmm. I'm from the West Side. I make no apologies for that. I know how to eat vienna wieners and potted meat and crackers and hog head salads. Y'all know nothing about it.
No, we don't.
Y'all don't. See, up at the Negro church. Anyway.
See, I wasn't going to even go there. But since you I know my brother got some questions, but since you went there,
yes.
You know, we have guests on the show, and we try to be accommodating to our guests on the show. Our you know, producer does all she can to make people feel comfortable. And and so, you know, we always ask our guests before they come, is there anything they need? You know, we've had, you familiar with Pastor Reggie Royal in Judah?
Yes,
he was here about 2 weeks ago, sitting right where you are. And we asked him, and he said, no, just, you know, have me a little water and a little juice. And then he said, the guy with me will have whatever I need. So, and I said, well, you know, so I said, well, did you ask Michael what he would require? And I was told.
Yes,
And you can clarify for
go
me.
Go ahead now.
That you required a six-piece from Harold's.
No, not Harold's.
Oh,
no,
I'm sorry,
no,
you
no.
said Joe's.
No.
What did you say?
I said Coleman's. Loose hair, foul demon.
See, that's
loose hair. Come on out. The devil is a liar.
That's a problem in itself.
Loose hair. Harold's is south, that south side chicken.
And Coleman's, huh? So it was Coleman's.
The rib.
It was with mixed sauce. Yeah,
it was cold.
See, now listen now,
it was with mixed sauce.
It was mixed sauce because listen, let me explain something to you. I am a Jimmy G's chicken person on the corner of Jackson and Kedzie Boulevard. They've changed their recipe. Anywho, and see, Coleman's was expensive. You know, you had to come way on this side to get Coleman's. You know, but you had Jimmy G's, and at that particular time, Smothers was real good back then. They had a good fish sandwich with cheese. But anywho, yeah, I was going to require that, but then I remember that I was going to wear a white shirt on today, and I didn't want to get the sauce on my shirt, if you will.
Well, just a week for future notices,
yes.
In case you happen to return, if they still let us be on the air after today,
Praise God.
We are a unpaid spokespeople for Uncle Remus.
Well, listen. I have no problems, children, with Uncle Remus.
Okay, I just want to make sure.
Now listen,
that's
listen
the best
now.
Sauce in the world. I don't.
No, nah.
You gonna stick with Coleman?
Now, let me tell you something. Let me tell you what the best barbecue sauce is in all the land.
Okay.
Open Pit is the best barbecue sauce in the heaven.
I ain't mad at you.
Let me explain something.
It's better than Sweet Baby Ray's. Yes, it is.
That's nasty. Sweet Baby Ray's.
Would you tell the people?
Listen, children, let me explain something to you. Listen, when I would come home, at that particular time, when Moo and Oink was next to Shooting Rogers Memorial Church of God in Christ, I would come and get gallons of the open pit barbecue sauce. I got the peoples in South Carolina loving the open pit barbecue sauce. They even selling the dollar stores down in there. Y'all don't understand, children. Forget what y'all talking about. This Sweet Baby Ray's and this Kraft and all
that mess.
Nasty foolishness. The devil is a lie.
Yeah.
Loose hair, foul demon. Come out of here, you cheap demon. Come on out of here. Glory to him.
All right. I'm just. Devon, did you? Because I'm trying to make sure the demon don't come back.
We switch gears back.
Please.
To,
Bring us back to
ministry.
Normal.
Come on back this way.
Yeah,
come back this way. Yeah.
So, what was that experience like when you first started pastoring in South Carolina, and what were some of the difficult things you had to do while you were there pastoring?
If I can go back, I can go back before South Carolina. If I can go to Mississippi,
okay.
Let me go there if I can. First of all, was knowing the culture, because there is a difference in culture coming from Chicago, which is a church city, and then going down to Mississippi, it was one of those culture shocks. I went from where buses ran and this, that, and the other to Mississippi, where they roll up the sidewalks at 5 o'clock. Church was my life. You know, we would stay in church back then church schools will start at
forever.
Forever. We'll start at 9:30, and by 1:30, church will be over. 2 o'clock, then we'll be getting ready for the 3 o'clock program. When I went south and church started at 10:30 and was out at 12 o'clock, I did not know how to behave.
Wait a minute, it started 10:30 in the morning.
10:30 in the morning, and was out at 12
noon.
You can't hear. You don't hear what
That's
I'm saying.
That's why I had to.
Woo! I said, now what have we been doing all of our lives? Of course, then I went around the corner to Sanctified Church, and they got out about 1 o'clock. But they started at 11, though. But it was the culture shock and me slowing down.
Okay.
That's what the big thing was. And also learning that people in the South, everyone is connected to somebody's church. Everybody. They may not go. But they are connected to Great Mount this or New Mount or number two, number three, and number four. Mm-hmm. And I, at that particular time, you all, I was pastoring in a Methodist church. I was United mm-hmm. Methodist.
Okay.
And I went to United Methodist school. Thank God for it. It paid for tuition. But anyway, that's another story. Mm-hmm. Just getting, being able to know the culture, even in South Carolina.
Okay.
And in South Carolina, I want you to know, South Carolina was very different because, and those who are African American know what I'm about to say. South Carolina is divided two ways.
Mm-hmm.
After slavery, the owners of the plantation took, for lack of a better term, the house slaves to the upper part of South Carolina.
Mm.
And left the other slaves in the lower part.
Mm-hmm.
And it's totally different. It's a total different mentality from the lower part of the state to the upper part of the state.
So it caused some division between black folk.
Oh, my God.
Mm,
okay. I mean, you'd be surprised. You'd be very, very, very surprised. Let me, the thing that happened in Charleston is the lower part of the state.
Ah, okay.
Columbia is the dividing part. And I passed it in the upper part of the state. And I was amazed at the mentalities. I was also amazed because when you hit South Carolina on 85, mm-hmm. all the way to North Carolina, mm-hmm. now you know that the Fire Baptized Holiness Church is there in South yes. Carolina, but they're not a very intricate part. I was interested because I couldn't find good musicians.
Mm.
And the reason being is because there is no prominent sanctified church in the upstate. Oh, now come on now, because you know where there's a sanctified church, there's musicians.
At least one.
Oh, yeah, there's one.
Yeah, you're going to have some.
Yeah.
I mean, come on, let's just. That's what the talent is.
Because let's just be
honest. They taught us in the sanctified church that you don't pray for money, you pray for the Lord. So all of us will try to get on the organ. We'll talk about that later. Well, all of us will try to get on the organ just to play our little dum 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 dum.
Right,
bum,
right.
Bum, you know. But it was a transition and me slowing down
mm-hmm.
because Chicago is fast. Yeah, me slowing down. So that's it. Just knowing the culture.
Just knowing the culture.
Yeah, mm-hmm. knowing the culture. And believe it or not, even here in Chicago, there are certain cultures that go with certain areas.
Mm-hmm. True. Yeah. North side is completely different from the west and the south side.
Oh my God.
Yeah, that's because North side really believe they're Evanston.
Yeah, they really do.
They really do.
Yeah, they really believe
they're Evanston.
And then the south side, that's a whole other different story.
Well.
And now one of the biggest problems, now no offense, one of the biggest problems I've had, especially when I tell people I'm from Chicago, ooh, Chicago, listen, let me tell you, I had to tell them, I am from the west side now.
Yeah.
When I was growing up, and you're from the west side, of course,
mm-hmm. yeah.
all this killing and stuff that was going on wasn't on the west side.
It was our south.
It was on the south side.
That's true.
Because we are a more closely knit group. We used to be
mm-hmm.
mostly closer knit group on the west side.
Used to be. It's correct.
Everybody knew somebody and was connected. Now, we would fight now. We would fight.
Yeah.
No shooting.
No, wasn't no shoot.
Right. We were going to fight.
Right.
The biggest rival we always had was Marshall against Westinghouse.
I could understand that.
Yeah, I mean, and listen, we were rivals. We were going to fight. But now, and I'm learning the West Side all over again, and you all, please forgive me for this. I'm missing something, and I'm missing the fear of God and the fear of your mama and daddy.
Yeah.
That's about right.
The reverence is gone.
I mean,
it's gone.
Completely.
It's gone. There are, and we one of the things that we've talked about quite often on this show is, it's because the where the church used to be involved,
yes,
they have completely turned into a turtle and went in, and we've retreated to the shell
yes.
of the building and left the community to fend for itself, and
it's awful.
Because one of the things we talked about, and you can probably attest to this, depending on which way you come to the church, if you're coming off the Eisenhower, if you're coming from the west or from east, you always get off at Central.
Yes.
When you get off at Central, you pass by this huge Greek Orthodox church.
Sitting right there by right Loretto Hospital.
Right next to the Loretto Hospital.
Yeah, Loretto.
Loretto. The Murder Hospital.
Uh-huh, the Murder Hospital.
The Pope used to go to die.
Say it right now.
That's what used to happen. I remember my mama got sick one time. She said, don't tell the Pope, take me to Loretto.
Listen, we go clean across the county. Listen, sit up there in the fantasy clinic and listen, almost die, but if you sit right there.
But what you notice is, and I've said this quite often, when you look at the surrounding area of that church, And I tell people this. I say, when next time you go by, slow down and look, or get out your car. You don't see a piece of paper, not a gum wrapper, around that church. Now, mind you, it's right across the street from Columbus Park.
Mind you.
It is right
where
there.
Where the bus turns around, mind you.
It's right there. And Pookie and Ray Ray, then you got, you know, your beggars on the corner. Mm-hmm. Uh-huh. But they're right. But you don't see that traffic in front of the church.
No.
But you come down the street.
Keep on going.
You
keep on going.
Back to where we are, uh-huh. right here. And it ain't nothing for somebody to dump out a whole bag of garbage right in front of the door of the church. I wonder what the Greek Orthodox Church, I don't know what they do in the community. I don't have a clue.
Right.
I know they have a lot of funerals and weddings. That much I do know.
Because everybody's old. So, yeah, they the funeral home love them. Thank you, funeral home.
But what the difference is, that the reverence or respect for that place is different. They hold that building in higher regard than they do the one where their people go.
I'm also thinking, and I will stand on this. Now, what is the pastor that was here for years?
Here?
Yes.
Pastor Horton?
Forever.
Until he died.
That was forever. Because, you know,
that's my grandfather.
Hey, well, it don't make no difference. He was here.
I'm just playing. Listen,
he was here.
Yes, forever.
There are three things that the old preacher did for us.
Uh-huh.
Okay? They demanded respect.
Yes.
They put the fear of God in us.
Mm-hmm.
And also, with them demanding respect, they also made us to love ourselves and respect ourselves. Mm-hmm. There was no question about that.
Mm-hmm.
When Reverend walked in, it was the end all to be all, because mm-hmm. he was respected. Mm-hmm. No matter what Reverend did,
that's right.
He was respected. And he was respected in the community.
True.
Period. And I think, and please help me with this, and both of y'all can help me with this. I think that this thing about being pastor and being a celebrity has gotten out of hand. Because it's wonderful that you can preach, but I want to know, can you pastor?
Wow.
Two different things.
Oh, my God.
Absolutely, yes.
Pastoring means shepherding.
Yeah, yes. Yeah, yeah.
Caring for the flock.
Yeah.
Can you pastor?
If you know anything about caring for sheep, you know you have to check everything. You got to check to see if they got holes in them. You got to check to see if they're sick.
Yeah.
Yes.
And so, that's true. But everybody now has the anointing to preach.
And you want
to
be apostle, bishop, overcoming, elect, and all of this. Listen, we didn't have all this when we were growing up.
We're going to go ahead because I'm going to talk about that.
And please forgive me because I can count Reverend Bronson pastored Christ T.
Yeah.
Reverend Miller pastored the church right next to him. I can come on down the street.
Uh-huh.
Cleve Minter pastored Mount Vernon.
New Mount Vernon, right
okay.
there, yeah.
Pastor Horace
Horton was here.
Mm-hmm. Let me go on down the street. Let me go to Reverend Jones down on the other side.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
These were people. I grew up with Johnny Miller,
mm-hmm.
With Leroy Elliott, who I've been knowing all my life.
Mm-hmm.
These are people who we knew would live forever, for lack of better terms.
You thought so.
Yeah, we thought they would live forever. These were people who pastored us.
Yes.
They may not have been the greatest preachers, but they pastored.
Mm-hmm.
And they knew what was going on. They visited the sick, whatever happened. Well, it's taken a turn for the worst. I think we're putting people in gaiters too soon.
Well,
and in tailor-made suit, because back then it wasn't tailor-made suit. You went to the mission shop down in North Riverside.
Mm.
Y'all don't hear me what I'm saying. And if you had any money, you went on Roosevelt Road. But anyway, that's another story. but I believe that we're giving, you know, the great, grand, and gloriousness.
Mm-hmm.
But they never talk about the gloom
of
this side of this thing.
Mm-hmm.
And we have gotten to the point to where it has become this. And maybe y'all can help me with this. It's a star-studded event, and it has really gotten a little bit next to me. Come on, talk about it. Let's talk about it since we're here.
We've had this debate. I shouldn't say debate. This conversation ourselves with all of these bishops. You know, you're a bishop, but you got one church with 12 people.
Because this room right here. Go ahead.
Yeah, you're a bishop.
Mm-hmm.
you an apostle.
Yes.
Well, you know, I'm sure I'm going to get in trouble with this, and we're going to have one on the show at some point, which probably won't be a good, well, you never know. It might work out all right. But, yeah, well, because I was checked for wearing I had, you know, on first Sundays, we have to wear a collar, which irritates me, but we have to wear this collar.
Yes.
And I.
Uniform.
Yeah, that thing. And we have, since it's summertime, we have to wear our white robes on first Sunday.
Of course.
It hot polyester.
Yeah, and gabardine. Robe,
That don't breathe.
That we going to get at Second Baptist. We're going to go ahead.
Right. Y'all got that?
We're going to get it, praise the Lord. This is why, sir? I grew up.
Okay, we're going to leave that alone.
We'll talk about that later on.
I bought a sister's, the robe was white.
Yes.
And it has a red, what's that thing called, stole that hangs over with the, you know. So I figured, well, I just go, you know, get a red shirt to match, you know.
No.
Uh-huh. Yeah, because somebody sent me a Facebook message.
You're not a bishop.
They told me. you can't wear that. Is that, the first they said, is that a red shirt you're wearing in the picture that I saw? I said, yeah.
Uh-huh.
He's, why are you wearing red? That's the next question. I said, well, because it matched my white robe with the
red. Right, with the red.
With the red.
I had on red shoes and red white socks.
Well,
what?
My socks did have some red in it.
Of course it did.
The shoe and sock ministry is strong over here.
Listen.
Come on now.
Listen, children,
out.
You must have the sock and shoe ministration. Huh?
Come on, somebody.
Why don't y'all help me, praise the Lord?
So he said, well, you know, I don't mean no harm.
Okay.
But, you know, that's reserved for bishops and apostles.
Yeah.
I said, oh, well. So I said, well, I've not been called to be a bishop. And I said, I haven't seen the risen Jesus, so I can't call myself an apostle. That didn't go over too well.
Oh, of course it didn't.
So help me with when we had Pastor Reggie here, he made a comment. He said, you got a bunch of these rogue churches. With these rogue preachers.
Off-brand holiness. Go ahead. Yes. Off-brand holiness. What do you mean by that? Listen, if you're not Church of God in Christ and apostolic, you're off-brand.
Yeah, exactly. Because it's the only way to God.
Come on. One way to God.
If you're not in their organization,
you can't just join in. You got to be born in. Of course, it's what they say, but that's another story. We'll talk about that later on.
That foolery in itself, when you talk about millennials,
won't
know part of that.
No.
Your uniforms and all. I mean, it's one thing to do it. You know, I understand if you have to do it for some event. I'm not big on events, but if you have to do it for some event, I get that one event. But to tell me that, you know, my holiness is in question because I'm not wearing the proper vestige or whatever it is.
The vestiture.
Yeah.
Now. Here it is. Now, I don't have any problem with. Now, one of the things that the millennial group and our age group, mm-hmm. we enjoy is we like the sacredness of mm-hmm. church.
True.
And we want stuff to point us toward mm-hmm. church. Mm-hmm. You know, we need a cross. We need something. We just don't need to hear. And please don't misunderstand me. We don't mind the praise and worship, but don't give us too much of it. Give us a church song, please. Give us some church music because that's what, you know, gets us going. But now this is the problem. First Sundays, all right, we can be ceremonial on first Sunday. You know, put on your robe, put on your preaching dresses because I put them on, and all of these good things. Put on your preaching. I'm going to wear the preaching dresses now. I believe in them.
I saw the clip.
Oh, yeah, I believe in the preaching dresses now. But now, here is the thing. The thing about it is, I'm Baptist.
Mm-hmm.
I am in my soul. Okay. I'm Baptist. I'm saved.
Okay.
So with us, I can wear any color I want to. Mm-hmm. I can wear pewter green if I want to.
Pewter
green.
Okay.
I can wear periwinkle if I want to. Okay.
That's a good color.
I'm
though.
Baptist. Oh, yeah. Right. Yeah. Periwinkle. Yeah. The wonderful color.
The wall.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. The Lord is all right. And so it has nothing to do with, you know, If you're in a connectional church, we understand that.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm Baptist.
Mm-hmm.
And Baptist folk been wearing stuff for years. Yeah. I mean, who is it? First of all, let's go to, what's my church over on the south side? Greater Harvest.
Okay.
Oh,
all right.
Oh my God.
All right. Let's go to Greater Harvest. Now, them children going to sing and them children going to shout. I'll leave right there. Anyway, but
you've never heard of?
No, I haven't been there. No.
Jesus!
Talking
now.
About a praise.
Oh yeah,
I need to go there.
All children.
People show up just for the praise part and leave.
Oh, well, let me go on over that end.
Oh, I'm sorry. Anyway, I'm not sorry. No more. I wasn't supposed to.
Praise the Lord. But now, listen, Reverend Body was a sanctified Baptist church all of our lives.
Okay.
And they've been wearing colors and robes and mm-hmm. this, that, and the other all of our lives.
Mm.
You know, the spiritual church was nothing but the Baptist church and a little bit of the Catholic church coming together. That come on, y'all. That's all. And they've been wearing, Lucius Hall and them been wearing slips and robes and lace ever since we've been cheering.
You didn't have to bring up Lucius.
But anyway, First Church of Love and Faith. I want you to write me. Anyway, but because we are autonomous, we can wear whatever we want to wear.
Right.
Okay. Now, my pastor was a bishop. He was a bishop in an organization. Who was a Stone Baptist preacher, the late Bishop Keith Smith.
Mm-hmm.
And I talked with John Guns. I don't know if you all know, have you heard John Guns. He's out of Florida. And some people deter themselves from becoming these people, mm-hmm. bishops and this and that, with these titles.
Mm-hmm.
Because some people don't know what the title is all about.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because, and you know, people that say, and this is no offense, modern-day apostles are those who are supposed to set up churches and leave.
Come on, somebody. Come on, somebody.
If we're going according to the scripture. Apostolic sort of succession
uh-huh.
movement,
uh-huh. Uh-huh.
in which we said we're following Paul's example.
Come on, children.
We go and we find men
uh-huh.
to establish the church,
come
and
on.
Then we move forward.
And we, move uh-huh.
we father the church.
Right.
We make sure we continue.
Father.
We send That's, a letter but occasionally.
But you're the senior pastor, and your name is Apostle. Uh-huh. Okay.
Apostle E.Y. Itty. Now, the modern-day apostles are supposed to set up churches and move around.
Right.
I know a few modern day apostles.
Okay.
I really know a few of them.
Mm-hmm.
I would characterize Apostle Hinton as a modern day apostle because he has set up churches.
R.D. Hinton.
Yes, R.D. Oh, okay. Yeah, uh-huh. He been wearing. Lord Jesus. God bless you tonight. This is Apostle Hinton. And we want to thank God for you tonight.
That was my when my great grandmother was living, when she wasn't feeling well. That was her TV pastor.
Oh, yes.
When she couldn't make it to Metropolitan
okay.
Missionary
yeah, Baptist Church. Oh, Johnny Ledbetter.
No, Johnny Lee Taylor.
Reverend Taylor.
Yeah.
And after they put him out, then Craig Smith came. But anyway, yeah. And yeah, praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, after they put him outside his own church. But anyway.
yeah, because you went to Greater Love.
Yeah, right, he sure did. All right, I'm sweet. Anywho. And there are a couple of modern day. I remember Apostle Earl Skinner when I was growing up who would go and set up churches and mm-hmm. this, that, and the other. But now, if you are an apostle,
mm-hmm.
where's your fruit?
Mm. Mm.
I'm not knocking anybody now. Mm. Hear what I'm saying.
It's a good question.
Where's your fruit?
Mm.
Now, some of my members of Second Baptist, y'all looking at this, y'all better say something on the ether wave. Yeah, type in "Hey man" or something. But where is your fruit?
Mm-hmm.
And I don't have anything against you. If you are an apostle
mm-hmm.
and you are in a building, praise the Lord, mm-hmm. And you've been there forever, why is it raggedy? Why is it falling down?
Mm.
Where's your fruit?
Mm. Wow. Look here, y'all. We're talking with Pastor Micheal B Henderson here from the Second Baptist Church. Chicago boy sitting here talking to us. Actually, we're doing some reminiscing, seriously,
yeah. Oh, yeah.
Going on up in here right now. Hey, look, man, we're going to take a quick break so everybody can catch their breath after that. Then when we come back, we're going to jump back into some other questions. Let me give y'all a little music here. What am I going to do here? Yeah, let's get a little smoky. Smoky will get us through. We'll be right back, y'all. Taking lemons off. We be right back. I say that 7 times.
Now it's a breeze. Yeah, praise him for that breeze. Praise him.
The Lord is in the air.
Yeah, that stuff in here. New strain. We still up. We don't take breaks on New strain.
So we. Bless y'all tonight. God bless your woman, beloved. Hallelujah.
Yeah, we don't do sweet. But you sweep everything. But see, I doctored up my open pit. But yeah. Open pit got to be the base. It's the base.
That open pit is horrible by itself.
But no, I can dip a fry off in there.
You can?
Oh, I can. It's got to be hot though. But I can dip a fry. It's open. But that's your base.
I mean,
Yeah. Now that Sweet Baby Ray mess,
I take some honey barbecue sauce, Sweet Baby Ray style.
You can put some honey in some open pit and do some things.
I don't like the base of the open pit.
But if you don't know.
I've seen people doctor it.
No, you got to.
It still has that open pit.
No.
It's an even mustard.
You got to get in the brown sugar.
Well, you might you might as well make your own sauce then.
That's what I'm doing. Nobody got all day for that. It's hot. It's like a day like today. No, you got
to put that open pit on the grill.
Right. That is. Ooh, what time you took it? We went on last week. I'm about to come out to the Second Baptist. Take them around the corner, the Second Baptist. You good? You need anything? Got your water? You good? Okay. We good over there?
I'm trying to make sense of my life.
Oh, wow.
I'm trying to overcome all the
pain. Yeah, man. Have you had any since you've been back?
Oh, yeah. You're going to be disappointed.
Yeah, it's no longer that. Now they have the one location they just remodeled right here in Chicago Avenue.
You got a hold on to your faith.
You about the Polish place?
Just remember
where you get the Polish. It's still there.
It ain't the same. They cleaned out the Greeks. Come on, don't help me help the bear. You listen, when these places clean up, they mess up.
You know what? I'm done.
Really?
We're going to end early today, show.
That's why everybody's
I don't even know what to say.
Come on,
we coming back off this break. Really?
Get things on YouTube.
Young Ustream, y'all get stuff that the rest of the radio folk.
Yeah, so it's important to watch both.
Y'all, my mind has been blown during the commercial break. I can't even.
How we admire poison.
Yeah.
That's bad for the soul.
So
hey, they took the grease off.
Listen, let me tell you all something. Come on, West Side. I want y'all to chime in with me. Listen, when Al's on Lake Street. Mm-hmm. Cleaned up the fragrance, the feather of the food left. Y'all ain't got to say it, man. I know I'm preaching.
So what happened to Rib Palace right here on Lake Street?
You know, I ain't never been that far.
They wasn't never good. That bucket of tip. I had a problem with a bucket of tip.
That's
I don't know. Something about a tips in a bucket.
A whole bucket.
Just don't.
Didn't that come in no bucket but KFC when we were growing up. That was hot chicken.
Right. Huh? Because you went to churches?
Listen, let me explain something to y'all about churches. My sister and my brother have worked there for years. Listen.
See,
you
my mama
feed...
was bougie. We went to Brown's.
Listen, Brown's they had good mushrooms and good gizzards.
Bless the
Oh, my God. Listen. Children. you know, they just, some people just messed up. Now, Wiley's, I don't know if y'all have had Wiley's barbecue on Madison. Wonderful. The Holy Ghost,
the new,
hallelujah, in the marrow of the bone.
By Hamlin up there?
Yes, wonderful stuff. Don't knock until you try.
I have tried it.
I tried it. I know I found it to be a friend. Praise the Lord. I know too much about him. On him, I can't depend. However, Home Run Inn has changed their sauce, and it's not good on that pizza.
Did you go to?
All of them.
Okay. All right. Because, see, I...
The one off of Mannheim is not doing it for me, children.
Oh, no.
Okay, thank you.
Exceptionally bad.
Okay.
Exceptionally bad.
Now, y'all don't be calling us.
That don't mean we don't want Home Run In for a sponsor.
Right. Exactly.
See,
now, we want Home Run In for sponsorship.
These Negroes over here trying to y'all messing with the church's money.
We wouldn't mind having Joe's on Madison giving us some hot link. Y'all, they got a
hot... Oh, jokes,
no, you don't want that no more. You haven't had one? Oh, Jesus. Let me
hook you up. Don't see a foul deal.
There's a new place you need to try.
What about?
I guarantee you don't know nothing about it. It's in Forest Park. That's going to mess with your first.
Okay, Forest Park.
Uh-huh. Right across from Bill Winston's...
center. Uh-huh. Right. Yeah, everything.
Smoking M's.
Smoking
M's. Smoking M's. It just say barbecue on the outside.
That's, okay, but it's pretty good.
Yes, sir. They got a hot mild mix sauce in there. You might want to anoint somebody.
Okay, well, I'm going to try that and see about it.
I had some last night.
Well, now, listen here. We're going to go back to church. Yeah, but now, I'm upset because, beloved, that they closed down Edna / Ruby's restaurant. Children, I grew up when Edna's was on Kedzie, right next to 6 South Kedzie. And then after the grocery store burned down, they moved around the corner. And then her daddy died, and then she died, and then Ruby them came in to get it. And I went by there because they had a sumptuous, if you will, caramel cake. And I went by there, and my face was crunched. Because they said out of business permanently.
Yeah, they now, children. Their license probably wasn't no good.
Now, children.
Well.
And it's a shame that I have to journey mm-hmm. all the way by my house mm-hmm. to Priscilla's. We want you to be a sponsor. I can't get in MacArthur's. I don't know what they're serving over there, but honey, you can't get up in there on no Sunday evening.
Don't believe the hype. First of all, when your sweet potatoes come out of can, I'm going to leave it alone.
Mm. We still want you for sponsorship, if you will.
No, we good on that.
We're okay, we're good. All right. Good. And okay. Is this on North Avenue, the 68, 70 or whatever, the 68? Yeah.
You notice the producer know about all the food.
Oh, yeah. Let me explain something to you.
Shade, look at
we believe. Talk about, pick one.
Uh-oh.
Whichever one you want to pick, baby.
You do know she's amen in all of the restaurants.
But now, listen, here's the thing. Listen, that, and I'm saying that, I know we're joking about it, but y'all, that was a sense of ministry, too.
Yes, it was. Yeah, it was. It was.
Listen, when you were in church, when you were going, now, what church are you from, may I ask?
What are you looking at me for? What are you looking at me? What church you at?
No, I was going to say First Kingdom, but then I had to think back. So I come from New Abundant Life Church right off of 5th and Lake Street in Maywood.
Tell them who the pastor is. Bishop.
Bishop Monroe Mullins.
Mm, you don't know that.
Man. I don't know him.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
That must be one of them new star churches. How long they been together?
I want to say since maybe early 2000.
Okay, I've been going. I left here in 93. So, and then, you know, Maywood, all we knew was Bishop Chambers was out there. Yeah. And we knew mm-hmm. that Donald Alford was out there. And then we knew
the one from
Wiley was there.
Wiley
Second Baptist. Mm-hmm.
So where are you at now was the question, sir.
Where I am now, yeah. I'm on the south side. I'm over at St. Philip's. St. Philip's Missionary Baptist Church.
Where is it? Why do these west siders want to go over to the south? We don't belong over there.
Well, he got an assignment.
Oh, well, listen, Check. Let me just explain something to y'all. Let me just explain something to y'all about Check. Marlon! Some check is better than no check at all. Come on, children. Why don't y'all help me preach tonight? Y'all not helping me. I know anybody done called in, but y'all pray for me.
They just ain't pushed the button.
Yeah, they just ain't pushed the button. Just nothing. But that's all right. Thank y'all for listening. Maybe I have to come back again.
You
know?
Might. If we ain't off the air.
Yeah, praise the Lord for censorship. But that was, that was a part of, listen, growing up again, and I'm sorry for suffering from nostalgia. You know, you would come to church, mm-hmm. you would go get you something to eat, mm-hmm. be ready for the 3:30 program, mm-hmm. go to somebody else's church, mm-hmm. you would fellowship. Mm-hmm. This was a time when we enjoyed church.
Yeah.
Church was a part of our lives. Mm-hmm. And one thing that I found out when I lived south and I pastored south, listen, let me tell you the four things. If any of them were out of whack, your whole life was out of whack. Jesus. Mm-hmm. Family, mm-hmm. and you can put church in there, mm-hmm. and football.
Okay.
Okay?
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Now, when football season was over, it was going to be family, mm-hmm. Jesus, and church. Mm-hmm. If any one of them were out of whack.
Something was wrong.
You were out of whack. Mm.
So I have to ask you a question. So you're pretty familiar with the churches on the west side. Before New Abundant Life, there was Bishop Kirkwood.
Oh, right, well, Joel Kirkwood. Yeah, of course.
Yeah, that's where I had my apostolic experience.
Oh. Well, you got to speak in tongue to be saved.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus.
You got the rules out of my home. Yeah. Yeah, Bishop Joel Kirkwood.
Yeah, his son is over there now.
When y'all
going to
find the interpreter somewhere for me?
Right, that interpreter is bring food. All right.
And they had church all day.
Any of
the sanctified churches, apostolic, Pentecostal church was all day.
Mm. All day long.
So and we're going to take this quick break, but we're going to come back for night service.
What year was this?
Listen, this probably stopped in the 2000s, maybe.
But this was in the 90s.
Yeah, this was the 90s.
I thank God for my sabbatical.
Listen,
this was in the 90s.
But it was, listen, it was.
I didn't know church in the 90s. I'm sorry.
I grew up. My nickname was Preacher when I grew up. I was small. That was given to me by one of my teachers.
Mm-hmm.
So, but then I'm going to be honest with you. I had the respect even of my community.
Mm-hmm.
They knew if they were doing something, Preacher, go home.
Mm.
Mm-hmm. I mean, go home because you ain't gonna be a part of it. You ain't gonna be a part of this,
right?
And I have to ask this question. Of course, you all have to forgive me because I am a preacher. So here's the storyline: that people went over to Africa for a trip. They enlisted some people from that country to go with them, and they had traveled. And they had told the people, "We need to stop for a minute." I said, "Why?" I said, "We've traveled a long distance in a short time." And we have to allow our souls to catch up with our bodies.
Mm-hmm.
And the question is, you all, are we so busy doing ministry, quote unquote, that we are leaving our souls behind?
Mm. Wow.
And it makes no difference if you're Baptist, Catholic.
Right.
I have something to say from the West Side. Let me just talk from the West Side perspective. And I love the West Side. You all, please hear me what I'm about to say. But I've always wondered why we've never had a quote-unquote mega church on the West Side.
Hmm.
I wondered why they was not doing any mega ministries. And what I call about mega ministries is owning apartment complexes, senior living, things of that nature.
Mega ministry do mega things.
Yes.
Well, Bill Winston, Dr. Winston didn't get or out of that capacity, he had to move off of Pulaski and Lake for the church to move forward.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And I applaud Reverend Ackery for doing the wonderful work he's doing. I'm sitting here at a stalwart church kingdom.
Yeah, yeah. But
that's been here
43 years.
Forevermore.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? And the question is, because my thing is ministering to the body, soul, and spirit, always. What else? Food pantry. We have a food pantry. Mm-hmm. Thank the Lord in LaGrange. We do, and we feed many people with the food pantry. And I've always wondered, with the great minds that we have on the West Side, why is it that mega ministry is not done?
I'll jump on this real quick, and it's probably not going to go well, but we've had, you know, Pastor Clarence Storrs?
Yeah, oh, Ma's here. Ma's here.
Okay, you know, his father was pastor first.
Oh, yes.
Okay.
Yes.
So I had him here back in April as well, and we talked about why there is such a disconnect between ministries.
Okay.
And some of it is ego.
I agree wholeheartedly.
Let me rephrase that. Most of it is ego.
Let's say 80%, if you will.
Yeah, okay.
Let's say 80%.
Is ego. And then the other part is people are afraid that if I bring my people where your people are, your people come where my people are, your people might want to stay. I might lose some membership because over here where we are strictly traditional and we all like this, and at your church we can praise and fall out all over the place. Well, I've been wanting to do that for the longest, so I'm gonna go over here to Mars Hill because I ain't gonna stay over here at Kingdom where we got to sing four hymns and take up seven offerings and blah 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 blah. I'm just joking. I know we don't do that no more, so y'all don't go call and tell nobody
Hallelujah.
I said that.
Hallelujah.
But but you know, but people and there's an issue. We've had several things that we've tried to do outside of the normal church routine. Myself with Devon and our producer LaTanya, we put on, it was for the church, we helped put on a outdoor fest in Duke Ellington's parking lot, which is right across the street over here from the church. We rented a tent. Tent pretty much covered the whole parking lot.
Okay.
And we had medical people come out and all this stuff. We invited every church all around here.
Wow.
Didn't get a response.
How interesting.
but yet you claim you are for now. And I brought that to Pastor Storr's attention, and that's when I told him, he was like, well, you know, anything going forward, you send it directly to me and right. not to the doorkeepers.
Right.
And I get that. But even in the community, speaking of the West Side, Austin community where we are, there is a faith-based meeting every first Tuesday of the month at the 15th District Police Station.
Okay.
And it's so that the community leaders, church leaders, and people in the community can come together with the police to talk about what's going on, mainly right now, all the violence and everything else. Well, I go representing my church, but when you get in there, I'm not a pastor. I'm just a right. minister on the roster over here.
Right.
There are three pastors in the room. Well, how many churches are in the Austin community?
Oh, God.
Uh-huh.
I mean, beyond.
But there are three pastors in the room. But yet you go to y'all. But then I see on Facebook where y'all got y'all breakfast meeting and then y'all hanging out together. And then when I ask a question, you know, they say, well, don't assume we're not talking about the community. I'm not assuming anything. I just want to know, you know, if you're having these meetings, why isn't the rest of the community involved? You know, when the police commissioner came out, superintendent, he came out, you know, there was a meeting over here at Mars Hill that, you know, I assume it was kept under wraps because they didn't want a bunch of people there asking questions. But if he's out answering questions, then people in the community and other community leaders or churches should have been involved. We've been over here for years. You know, like I said, 43 years this church has been here. Mars Hill has been there forever.
Yes.
New Mount Vernon has been there forever. Saturday was my first time in my whole black life
okay.
that I've ever been in New Mount Vernon. They have a brand new pastor.
Yeah, they do.
Just what's his name? You know the
Bruce Hayes.
Bruce Hayes. Okay. I just met him, young guy. Yeah, he younger than y'all. And I'm like, man, I'm tired of being the old person in the room.
Hey.
But you're still calling me elder.
Yeah, elder. Bless you. That's your elder name. Yeah, you can wear your purple.
But that's the next color. See, you call yourself cardinal. See, already.
Oh yeah, I'm His Holiness.
Right, everybody knows
I'm the next step up from Pope. Forget what y'all talking about.
I'm striving for Pope. I'm on my way. Yeah, okay.
Well, yeah, the Vatican gonna be in LaGrange.
We gonna have to.
That's gonna be the Vatican. Where's the Vatican?
I just met this young man, and you know he got some great ideas. I'll talk to him. He'll be on the show. But it shouldn't have been that disconnect. Reverend Mentor, I don't know who he is, but he was there forever.
Yeah, Cleve was.
Pretty much died in the pulpit. I mean, he was there forever.
Well, now one of the things that has happened is, and this is the truth, and of course, with pastors, mm-hmm. sometimes you have been bitten wrong by some other preachers. There's nothing like getting hurt by other preachers and pastors. Mm-hmm. And sometimes you have to be, because listen, we're up here, you and I, all three of us, mm-hmm. with your producer, we're talking and this, that, and the other.
Mm-hmm.
Well, somebody that does not know us will say, you know, Henderson was up there mm-hmm. Talking crazy and this, that, and the other. But mm-hmm. it was all of us.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't just Henderson.
Right.
It was all of us.
But they're going to say it was you.
They'll say it was me.
Right.
And so.
It was.
It was me. Yeah, it was me. It was me. So the trust factor and the trust issue.
Yes.
Has a lot to do with it. And as younger pastors, when I say younger pastors, if you are a pastor and you are in the age bracket between 30 and 50,
mm-hmm.
one of the things that we're very suspicious of one another.
Mm-hmm.
We just are.
It's natural.
Yeah, it's a natural thing. And mm-hmm. I have friends that I'll have forever. Now, when it comes to Chicago, do mm-hmm. I have any preacher friends here? Reverend Norman Donahue at Three Crosses of Calvary, mm-hmm. I've been knowing forever. Mm-hmm. Reverend Johnny Dodd, that's on off the expressway, I've been knowing him, played an intricate part in my life.
Mm-hmm.
But anybody else? You know, I know Stevie Thurston, I know Leroy Elliott, I know Johnny Man, I've been knowing them, but as friends, no.
So who do you have, since we went there, who is your spiritual covering for you?
My pastor died 2 years ago.
Wow.
And so now I have a friend who has been like a pastor to me, and that's Dr. Brian Cheeks, that's in South Carolina.
Okay.
But now I'm trying, let me tell you about my pastor. My pastor, Keith Smith, would mm-hmm. preach all over the land and country. We didn't have a lot of members. We had about 60 members, but we had great quality. But what I liked about my pastor is that I could be myself around my pastor,
mm.
and then he was spiritual enough to tell me when to sit down and be quiet. And I respected him
mm-hmm.
for that, because mm-hmm. I got some flaws.
Mm-hmm.
I'm just being very honest with you. I got some flaws. Mm-hmm. And he saw my flaws, but he saw the anointing in my life enough to let me be Michael Henderson.
Okay.
But also to, when I got wrong, come on back over in here.
Mm-hmm.
He had enough Holy Ghost, and he was human enough.
Come on somebody.
You know what I'm saying? Uh-huh. And it wasn't always, oh, praise the Lord, hallelujah. It was, Mike, come on in here, get some of this here, some of this here drunk chicken over here, and sit down and talk to me. What's going on? And he was smoking a cigar. Come on in here. You need one of these over here. And loved me enough to tell me, now listen, you need to go pray. You need to sit down with the Lord. You need to tarry with the Lord. And so I've been trying to find someone. I'm not him, because he's gone.
He's gone.
But I've been trying to find someone and where I can be who I am, but have enough Holy Ghost to come pull me back in. And that's hard.
Wow.
Finding pastors for pastors is very hard.
Yeah, especially when you don't like for you're already in the position.
Yes.
For somebody like me, who, as my mama said, please don't be nobody. My mother has told me on several occasions, don't be nobody's pastor, because you ain't gonna have no members, because except for me and a few other folk, because you gonna put everybody out the minute they
start. Get out!
Right. So she has told me that on several occasions.
You have to be somebody's good. Listen, this is my assistant pastor, children. Anything that has to go through him. And listen, and you need people like that in church, believe it or not. Because we as pastors, we're very giving. We give everything.
Mm-hmm.
And we don't want to say no to anybody. But there has to be somebody around you that ain't afraid to say, pastor ain't doing that.
Yeah.
Nope.
Yeah, I used to be well, and you know, then the title that they gave me around here was the dough keeper.
Okay,
because I used to keep all of the foolery, on Sundays. You know, you want to? I need to talk to the pet. No, not before he preach. You don't. No.
I'm sorry. I do have a friend out there, Bishop Al Reese.
Okay,
my good friend.
Okay.
But when it comes, and I'm sorry for just finding somebody, and I may have to go out of state. Who knows? It doesn't bother me. The Lord will allow me to know.
Mm-hmm.
That's one of the biggest issues that's facing ministry today. So finding those preachers who love us enough to sit us down and mentor us and not want to prostitute our gifts.
Wow.
That's a whole nother story all in itself.
Yeah, you would know, wouldn't you?
Yeah. and you know, it's funny, because we're trying to figure out, we have the cliquishness, but we still have the separation.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
It's not saying, okay, even if this is your clique of people,
mm-hmm.
let your clique of people, my clique of people, let us all get together for one cause. You know, if it's to demonstrate that we want a God culture on the west side of Chicago,
yes.
All it takes is for us to get pulled together. I don't care who you go and get.
Yeah.
The point is, I need you to show your face
so
that people can see that, listen, I care about you.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't just show up to your place of worship or in your community, because most of the pastors are probably, none of them live in the community.
Right.
So that's a whole nother story. Yes. So what we've come to realize is that, as my good friend, Apostle Ronnie Austin said, you want to be big, but little got a hold
choking
of you.
Choking you. Got you in a headlock and won't let you go.
So here it is. You know that you have a storefront church and you got 10 members. What else better do you have to do than to be impactful in your community?
But I'm a bishop.
But see,
and so now I've come to realize two things for me with the move. This is their move.
Mm-hmm.
The move and flowing in, I'm looking for the title. Mm-hmm. If I can get the title, it gives me the credibility.
Mm-hmm.
The credibility gives me a platform to rub elbows with other people.
Yes.
And so it's not about me winning souls. It's about me preaching and platform so that I can pay bills.
Yeah.
So where does that leave the community? Because the only thing you're doing is getting me to show up to your church, preach the people out so I can walk home with a check. So now the people, and here's the insult to the injury, is that you preach foolery to me. There's no truth. And so I'm still broke as I was when I walked through the door when I leave. Both mentally, physically, and spiritually. Also spiritually.
I think one of the things that, and he said something, and as I tell people, I can preach every Sunday. I can preach for Women's Day at the church where I pastor.
Mm-hmm.
And I thank God for Second Baptist. I'm not, and please don't get me wrong, I don't need no star-studdedness. I don't need a 15-bedroom house and all this kind of stuff. I need to live. Mm-hmm. And I want to let everybody know that's in full-time ministry, because I didn't go to school to be an engineer.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't go to school for anything. I went to school to better myself in ministry. My mm-hmm. master's degree, mm-hmm. I didn't get it offline. I worked hard for mm-hmm. 3 years. Mm-hmm. I have a legitimate degree that I can go teach somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
However, I'm not going to starve my church and put demands on the church that they cannot meet. Now, and if I have to go get a part-time job, I don't have a problem with that.
Mm-hmm.
But he said something about rubbing elbows mm-hmm. with others. Who cares? And listen, it took me 37 years to get here. I'll be 41 in November.
Mm-hmm.
To the place to where it clicked in my head.
Mm-hmm.
I don't need nobody to sanction me. Mm. Nobody to lay their hands on me. Nobody to speak up for me. Second Baptist, I thank the Lord for it, because I asked the Lord, if it's your will, I'll go.
Come on.
I didn't call nobody.
Mm-hmm.
The only person I know, because believe it or not, Elder Willie James Campbell's brother, Wardell, plays the organ there.
Wow. Okay.
Okay. Mm-hmm. When I walked in the door for the interview, I interviewed with them. This is how it moved. This is how it moved with Second Baptist. I sent them an application. I saw it online. I said, Lord, it's time for me to do something. I'm getting 40. It's time for me to, you know, do something else. I sent them an application. They called me. I interviewed with them in July
mm-hmm.
of last year.
Mm-hmm.
They asked me to come back and preach. When I walked in the door in October, I said, I know this fellow on this organ. It was Willie James Campbell's brother.
Yeah.
Wow. I said, well, hey, man, I've been knowing him forever.
Mm-hmm.
I preached. They called me back. I came back in November. They came to see me in February. They elected me in April. I didn't know nobody. Didn't no other preacher have to call for me. I had references of this, that, or the other. But it was the Lord's doing. Because I said I would never come back to Chicago. I really did. Mm-hmm. Never said I was coming back to Chicago.
Mm-hmm.
Because it would take a move of God, an act of Congress, and all this other kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. But there are some moves that are great moves, good moves, and God moves. This is a God move.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm at the place to where if you don't call me, fine. If you call me, fine. I'm fine. Mm-hmm. I got a check. Second Baptist takes good care of me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they take very good care of me.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't need to be in your clique. I don't need, listen, if TD Jakes calls me, that's great. Mm-hmm. But now my question is for those who are in ministry, what are you selling your soul for?
Mm-hmm. Wow. Wow.
For that fame.
Yeah.
It's that platform. See, because now, remember, preachers were never popular.
Never.
No.
Never.
And now you look at it, you know, people have put them on these platforms. Yeah,
they weren't popular, but they were respected.
Yes, exactly. That's it.
And now they want popularity and don't care about being respected.
Very, very minimal. Yeah. Very minimal.
Yeah. So you have this. They want to be TD Jakes, but they don't want to put in the work.
Yes.
You know, one of the things that we talked about this before, I think he interviewed with Oprah about 2 years ago, and when he talked about he started his church, I think he had 20 people.
He did.
20 people in
Charleston, West Virginia.
Yeah. You know, not too far from a coal mine somewhere.
Yes, that's right.
But he started that, but he knew then that that's not where he put in the work. Now we want people who were, and you know, you said some minute ago about online. Look, man, I ain't had time, so let me say this right now, because you talk about online schooling. First of all,
I think you're talking about those who pay for their credentials.
Yeah, that's what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about Webster. I'm not talking about Liberty.
Okay.
I'm not talking about that.
Okay.
These are reputable schools.
Well, you talking about the one where I send you $200
uh-huh,
and you send and you me a certificate.
And yeah, you take a test and you do all of that. No. Hear me now. Y'all listen. Because believe it or not, schools are going to online.
Yeah.
Now, don't please don't misunderstand.
I just wanted some clarification.
Because everybody can go do like I didn't go to seminary and this, that, and the other.
Yeah.
I'm talking about you ain't wrote no paper.
Nothing.
Yes,
you
sir.
Ain't did absolutely
uh-huh. nothing.
You have done scintilla.
Mm.
You have done the minute. And now you are Dr. So-and-so. And you want me.
Yeah.
My Lord. You want me to call you
Doctor.
Uh-huh. So-and-so.
A narcissist.
And right. You have done absolutely, positively the best nothing that you could do.
Narcissist.
Yeah. And I know it's about time for us to go.
Sweet.
But it's just the thing about ministry. It's livelihood.
Yeah, but I'm not going
to.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
No, you're good.
I'm sorry.
No, you're good. Go ahead.
Okay.
No, he's asking me about the time.
Okay. It's the thing about ministry.
Mm-hmm.
And ministry is not what a church is, it's what a church does. Mm-hmm. And my whole heart now is at the point to where I need to do ministry, because this is what my this is not my job. This is my livelihood. This is my career.
Yeah.
Right? And I respect all of those who have gone before me. God bless you. All of these things. I looked at and I studied Clay Evans for a while. And a lot of people, you know, a lot of people don't know this. But I remember Clay Evans at Fellowship had 80% of his members tithing.
I can believe that.
80%.
I can believe that.
And you know, statistics says that only 15%
pay for the whole
debt. Carry the back of the church.
Now
it used to be 20. It used to be 20. And now at Second Baptist, we're teaching about giving, not just tithing, but giving, because you're giving of your time, your talent, all of these things.
Yes.
And now, listen, I grew up half Baptist, half sanctified. I grew up, I grew up next to Gospel Temple on Congress where the Granberries were. I grew up. All right. Matter of fact, Elder Granberry baptized me years ago. One thing I noticed about the sanctified church, they taught us how to give.
Yes, they did.
Oh, my God.
Nothing else.
Yeah.
They taught us how to give
and
how to shout.
Don't forget about speaking in tongues.
Oh, yeah. You had to do that. Listen, we knew how to carry a service. Put your mind on Jesus. We don't have that. Put your mind on Jesus. But they taught us how to give. And I carried that throughout my life about giving. Mm-hmm. I know that whatever I have, I have to give something to the Lord. Because that, and people don't think. And what has happened is, and you all please forgive me, again, ministry has become star-studded with the Mercedes and with the Bentleys and with all of these things, the tailor-made suits, the Gators, the this, that, and the other. And that's not what it's about. Now, we want our pastor to look good. Ain't nothing wrong with the pastor looking good. Please don't misunderstand me, y'all. Ain't nothing wrong with it, because I'm a big Negro. I can't get nothing off the rack. I have to get it made because my midsection, my equator, is large. Hallelujah, Jesus. My arms are long. I got a big neck, praise the Lord. Even when I lose weight, I still got big bones. I'm still going to have to get stuff made. So don't knock me on that. But anywho, it's the thing. This is ministry. What are you doing for the people? All right, go ahead. I'm sorry.
Wow. No, well, normally our show is 90 minutes, but anytime we have guests, I always extend it out so we but real quick. You said something. When it comes to pastors in the community, now with LaGrange, it's a little different than being in the city.
Yes,
different. I was trying to be nice.
Come on,
come on. It's a whole lot different. And just for you know, like my residence is in LaGrange Park, so LaGrange Park is right next door to LaGrange.
Exactly.
But what's different is that there is community wise, you know, everything kind of settles downtown LaGrange.
Yes,
by the metro station.
Yes.
Everything is. Have you been to Al's? I'm not gonna talk about.
Food, yes, I have, and it got the Holy Ghost in the Mare and Fireside Pizza. Now my place. Listen, I walk from my house every Sunday through the community, and I go to Blueberry Hill Cafe to get my breakfast every Sunday.
I don't like that.
Well, I like it because they're talking about who this black man walking through here. I'm the pastor. Hey, pastor. Hey, I get to meet the people in the community when I walk.
Let me help you out with your breakfast, though. See, we back on food. This is your fault.
And listen, let me explain something to you. People don't understand about food. The Lord loves food. Huh? Because he made food. He told Peter to rise, slay, and eat. Hallelujah. When the widow at Zarephath, come on, children, I feel like preaching. She was about to make her last cake. Come on, cake. That's what? Food. Even when Adam ate off of the tree, it was what? Food. Come on, children. Why don't you help me in here this tonight? Glory to you.
Just to help you out with your breakfast, though.
Yes.
There's this place right next to the train station. It's called the Cow Bay Cafe.
Yes.
Now, they got, you need to go there for you.
Okay.
Try their breakfast.
And you see, I'm going to try them during the week. My Sunday.
I understand. I don't want to mess up your routine.
Yeah, my routine.
But try them during the week. Okay. They'll do something special for you.
Okay. And even though Tony's is down. But anyway, that's the story.
Okay. But how do you, what are you thinking? Because I know you said you've only been here since June. What are you thinking about doing to have some impact in that area? Because it's a little different you can't stand on the corner with your megaphone and look.
Come on, cheering, it's gonna rain. Come get the police, because mind you, listen, if you cross the street, that's Brookfield.
Yes.
That's Brookfield. Yeah, yeah. So my biggest thing is, because, and I had to get this because I have people that drive in.
Yeah.
My thing is, in the community, making it worthwhile and being a visible face in the community.
Okay.
It doesn't make me any difference if you, because I'm having a lot of visitors to come, which is great with me. Mm-hmm. But what I need Second Baptist to do is get on the train of hospitality.
Yes.
Now listen, I'm grateful. I am one of those people who believe in hospitality. The late Bishop Barnett Thorogood, who pastored in Virginia. Mm-hmm. Now let me tell you who he pastors. He's Missy Elliott's mama's pastor. He's Timberland's mama's pastor, and he's Pharrell's mama pastor.
Okay.
So we know what kind of offering that comes in.
Well, then,
once a year.
Come on.
Now he was the of hospitality. If you came in. First of all, he had greeters at the door.
Greeters.
He had people in the parking lot helping to park cars.
Oh.
When you came in, if you were a preacher and he had candy on his desk and you reached in there too many times, he would make sure you had candy to go back home with.
Mm.
My thing is, in all of these things, when people come in church, they're looking for a place where they feel comfortable, where I can bring my entire family. And now, and I want you all to hear this and hear this real well. And I learned this in the South. A harsh reality in the South is that we have big churches going up in the South in our communities that are not pastored by us, but are pastored by our Anglican brothers. Mm. Want to know why? Because they major in our minors.
Yes. Hospitality. Yes.
Okay? When you come in, if it's me, my wife, and children, I'm not married, don't have any children. Mm-hmm. They say nobody called me and told me about it. I'm so cute. But anyway, that's the story. Hey, everybody ain't live safe. Praise the Lord, y'all. Praise my son, the Lord. I'll be the one he called it for. Anyway, if I come in and I have a teenager, the teenager goes over here to the teen church. Mm-hmm. My little one goes over here to the children's church. Mm-hmm. I go in service. Mm-hmm. Okay? And this is the church that will remain nameless.
Right.
But they have praise and worship. Mm-hmm. They come in khaki pants. Mm-hmm. And then when it comes time for the pastor to preach, a screen comes down and the pastor preaches from
Satellite.
And we in there.
Wow.
And listen, and in an hour, listen, in 90 minutes, hear me now, and that's the Second Baptist, no, I believe in 90-minute rule. Mm-hmm. In 90 minutes, they are out of church. They've paid their offering. Uh-huh. They have had teen church. Uh-huh. My little one comes back with some Granimal crackers and some juice, and they hand me a coupon to go get $10 off at KFC.
Yeah, you're going to stay there.
That will attract the family.
I mean,
and this is every Sunday.
Wow.
And then we, no offense, we want to be traditional and stay in church all blessed day.
Mm.
Then we want to have crappy music, crappy, preaching, and I know old preachers say, you got to kill them every Sunday. Listen, that's the problem. You killing folk and not helping them.
Ooh.
I agree.
Yeah, I mean, come on now.
I got a 75-minute rule.
Listen.
We have a church in 75 minutes.
I'm trying to get there. I'm trying to get there.
Ed Young said, you can still turn around and put on a good service in 60 minutes.
Yes, you can.
And he said in 60 minutes. He broke down the time slot and said, we have church 1 hour. 1 hour of power.
I ain't there yet because the choir got to sing. And we got to sing, let the words of my mouth pump, let the words. Well, no, listen, there are some things we got to listen.
Y'all still do that?
But listen now. But now, I'm trying to get them to hear our prayer, Lord, and climb out of your door and grant us that peace. Amen. Because listen, let me tell you this. Church should be like Super Walmart. It's the only place you can go to get everything that you need.
Come on.
Because now, here it is. My older people, they are the ones that finance the ministry. My younger people are the ones that push the ministry.
Yeah.
Ah.
So I have to appease my Aunt Janes along with Janicina.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Yeah. It's true.
Yeah.
So and that speaks to, even when it talked about, because I was telling him about one of the new books I have called Preaching That Connects.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And in there it talks about how you can, if you don't purposely target out your group as you're putting together your sermon, it can be a one-tunneled vision sort of sermon, and there's one group you're talking to, but the other group understands absolutely nothing.
Right.
And so you're not able to connect with them. And so you talked about, you know, how important illustrations and things like that are.
Wow.
So even if what you're saying to them is not in an illustration form, it's in Bible because they know Bible, you use the illustration to connect the other two.
Amen. So we talked about you being out in LaGrange. We talked about your other church. So what is your staff look like right now? Do you already have a staff in place or?
Now I'm reading a book called Doing Church as a Team.
Okay.
I'm wonderful book. And I'm reading three books now. Mm-hmm. Doing Church as a Team, making change without making waves.
Mm.
And I'm reading Reaching People Under 40 While Keeping People Over 60.
Wow.
Reading those three books right now.
Wow.
I don't have a staff.
Mm.
And staff is very important.
Mm-hmm. You have deacons?
I have deacons. And listen, and I'm going to say this, y'all. I have the best deacon board this side of the world. The deacons at Second Baptist, no trouble. Trustees is another thing. But y'all pray for me. Y'all pray that my strength in the Lord about it. The only people that's really staff now I have maybe three people on staff. The person that does my finances, Elder Campbell, who plays for me, and myself.
Mm-hmm.
I am in need of a choir director because music is very essential in the black church.
It's part of worship.
I mean, listen, you got to have it.
You can't not.
And listen, we grew up to where little storefront churches was talking about celebrate thy king and ruler. I mean doing it when we were, you know.
Right.
Yeah.
And so that, and then I'm working on getting a church secretary. Now, people may not understand, why do you need a church secretary? Church secretaries are very important. Because nowadays, this like what we're doing right now, having an efficient website.
Yes.
Because when I tell people I pass the Second Baptist, the first thing they do is go to website. But now, and what you see is what happened in the past.
Yeah, yeah.
And we have to get that there.
Right.
Then Facebook and Twitter.
Social media, absolutely.
Social media is very, the evangelism now is not so much knocking on doors.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. That social media is the thing.
Yeah.
So getting them to that point and getting someone in who can address to all of that.
Mm-hmm.
So we're working on those things. Mm-hmm. Believe it or not, I have a great, and I'm grateful, Second Baptist, I have a great support system.
Okay.
And I'm grateful for Second Baptist because they went out on a limb and got a piece of fruit that they didn't know.
Mm.
And what is meant by that was they let me know that they were ready to be made whole.
Okay.
Some churches are not ready to be made whole. And I'll talk about that. Y'all have to bring me back. Talk about being made whole.
Wow.
Because it is not just doing church as usual. Because it doesn't work.
Come on, man.
I need some screens up in the church right now so we can get rid of bulletins. Right now.
Come on.
Now.
Hey, God.
Get screens up in the church.
We right in there.
To get rid of the bulletins. Yeah. I need them. And listen, and they love it that between 12:15, 12:30, we're gone.
What time service starts?
So our service starts at 10:59. if they're not up there, hey, y'all, we got to our church. Because we go to work on time.
Ooh, this sounds so familiar.
I mean, we go to work on time.
It's so wonderful. It's coming from a different voice.
I mean, we go to church on time. So then, listen, and then Maurice Watson, who now passes Metropolitan, in D.C.
Oh, I was going to say, okay. They finally got a pastor. I'm sorry. Oops, I mean no harm.
We'll talk about that later on. Oh, Jesus, we're praying, saints.
Man.
But now he passed the Metropolitan in D.C. He says one thing that has made him successful is he has learned to appreciate people's time.
Mm.
He's learned how to do that.
Mm.
How to appreciate people's time. Mm-hmm. And let's just say this. If our institutional churches...
Mm-hmm.
Do not change with the times. There won't be any more institutional churches.
Wow.
This is true. Because now when you go, for example, we went to visit a church.
Yes.
And I believe everybody in that church was at least 60 and older. 60 and older. Which, there were no younger people.
Which I don't name the church. Oh, yeah. Yeah, what the it's yeah. the it was the church that was birthed out of Taylor leaving Greater Love.
Young adults.
Yeah, if you,
there were no children.
Yeah, you'd be youth ministry if you went right
now. And I can't listen. If I don't hear no babies crying, I'm upset. Y'all have some chillin' around here.
They can't no more.
Well, that's why I'm getting some of my age group in here. Y'all have children. Because listen, these stalwart churches, and please out there in radio land, all the ether waves, I don't want you all to get upset about it. These churches that we grew up with,
mm-hmm.
we left and we went to college.
Mm.
Now, I'm just coming back after 22 years.
Yeah.
I'm just
that's right.
coming back.
That's right.
And some people are not coming back.
Yeah, that's
those of us right. that live in Cook County know that taxes are high.
Amen.
As a Georgia pine.
Praise him.
And listen, I want to move to DuPage County. Praise the Lord.
Yeah.
Taxes are cheaper. Yeah. But now we will drive if it's worth the drive.
Oh, we'll go anywhere.
If it's worth the drive now.
Because look at the folk that drive to Bolingbrook to Smoky Norfolk.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then please forgive me. I am leery of churches that got too many of me in there. Too many people my age?
Uh-huh.
Because we're transitional.
Yeah, we.
We are right now. Yeah. Okay, I'm 40. Mm-hmm. 45. Mm-hmm. And you 30 what?
Six.
Okay, all of us are at the age to where we're trying to become settled.
Yeah.
We're thinking about retirement.
Yeah,
we're
absolutely.
Thinking about all that. We're looking at who the oldest person was in our family mm-hmm. and gauge our age right there. Mm-hmm. So we're looking at that right now.
Right.
But people who are younger than us,
they ain't.
No, baby. Listen, they would rather get their nails done and vote for Chief Khalifa, whoever it is running for mayor, than they would for somebody with some sense. Mm.
Speaking of,
yes,
we got about 13 minutes left here. It was two clips I wanted to play we're not gonna be able to do it because it didn't load. But one was you had some comments about the state legislator here.
Listen,
not giving the could you expound on that a little bit with
let me tell you all something.
Not having a budget.
Let me explain something to you all. Let me explain. I was upset twice. Number one, I was upset with the teacher's pension.
Mm-hmm.
That you have to take care of bad children. You can't teach because you have disciplinary problems.
Right.
I mean, seriously.
Uh-huh.
And then you want to mess with their pension.
Mm-hmm.
And then this is what has happened is all of our teachers are gone.
Yeah, because they were old when we was.
They were old. They were old.
Yeah.
But then not only that. But the respect level for teachers, they get paid enough. Teachers do not get paid enough to be bothered with what they have to be bothered with now.
Especially in the urban community.
In the urban community. I'm thinking about going back to get a master's in counseling, to be a counselor at a school. I don't want to be in the classroom. Because I know what the teachers used to do to us. They used to whoop our behinds.
Yes.
But there was a connection.
Mm-hmm. With the parent.
That's with the parents.
Yeah.
And then this is what happened with me, and I'm going to go back to the other part.
Mm-hmm.
I went back to my high school, and I was just going through,
mm-hmm.
and I was talking to a young man. And the young man said, hey, my mama know you.
Uh-oh.
I said, well, your mama? Such, 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 such. This is a girl I went to school with.
Wow.
But then here's the other thing. The girl I went to school with got pregnant when we were in grade school. Now their child is like in their 20s, and they have little children running around. No offense to anybody.
Right, right.
You know what I'm saying?
But I understand.
And so the respect. So, and you all are talking about the teachers' pensions.
Mm.
And she was talking about cutting them. Mm. Then number two,
mm-hmm.
the state talking about cutting our funds.
Already did. Affected some folk that I know.
Mm.
Yeah. They had these programs where people who had these outrageous light and gas bills.
Yes.
And they cut the program, and now all of a sudden your bill that you had worked out an agreement with
uh-huh.
is now went from you paying $60 a month, they've tacked back on the $1,500 that you couldn't pay in the first place.
And then they don't want to work with you. My mother is raising my sister's children
mm-hmm.
because my sister mm-hmm. you know, has been out there in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And she depends upon the help
mm-hmm.
of the government
mm-hmm.
for my sister's children.
Mm-hmm.
But now, I mean, seriously.
Yeah.
The problem that I have with the legislation is that they have not walked a mile in our shoes.
None of them.
They have not walked a mile in our shoes
mm-hmm.
at all. And I'm totally upset about that because we do have people that with light bills.
Yeah.
People who are back in the day, we had ADHD, but we had Jesus and a whooping. Why y'all ain't saying amen out there in the ether waves?
Yeah, cause they, I'm so glad. I'm glad we didn't have it then. Cause
we had it though.
Did we?
Well, we had it.
ADHD.
Yeah, they had it.
Cause they would have had me on medicine.
Look, let me say something. They didn't have us on medicine.
Right.
They had a whooping.
That's true.
And go to the altar and get prayed for. Cause you need to be saved. You need to be delivered. Cast the demon out of your mind. Mm-hmm. That's what they had for us. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. That's what they had now. Yep. But then remember also, we didn't have these problems because we ate good food.
So the asbestos wasn't in the...
I don't know if it was asbestos, but we had grown accustomed to it. Uh-oh. We had neck bones and rice and gravies and stuff like that and pig ear sandwiches.
Everything
and
goes back to food.
Oh, yeah, it's going to go back to food now. But now with the food that they're having now, it's all tainted and all this kind of stuff. Uh-huh. So my problem with the governor is, and with the government, and then the problem I had was they went home to eat barbecue meat when the bill, when they had to still pass this here legislation. Y'all at the house, still getting y'all offering. So that's my problem.
Okay. So that was the one clip. Okay. And then there was the one that I was playing as you were sitting over there about you were having it was your first day back at the gym.
I ain't been back, y'all. Pray my strength in the Lord that I be the one he calling for. I've been walking though, you know. Listen, let me tell you all something. One of the problems I've had is when I moved south, I didn't know I had allergies so bad.
Okay.
Okay. Because up here, the air is a little thin, blah, 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 blah. And I have suffered from very bad allergies.
Okay.
So I have been on prednisone for the last 3 months.
Okay.
Prednisone is a steroid that adds weight to the peepers. And, beloved, I'm trying to work my way back to the La Fitness, L.A. Fitness, to the gymnatorium. And the Lord got to give me strength, beloved. Huh? Y'all ain't praying with the pastor. Y'all ain't praying with the cardinal. That the Lord would give us strength, that we would not have friction on the elliptical machine on the bicycles. But now, you know, while I'm laughing about it, every time I think I'm fat, oh, glory to God, somebody comes past me. Oh, bless his high name, and let me know. See, y'all don't have that problem. You know, y'all are normal sizes. You know what I'm saying? But, baby, there's always somebody that passes by me and lets me know, Lord, I thank you.
There's a ram in the bush.
Ooh, children. And then they want to wear skimpy clothes. Loose hair, foul demon. If you got Dunlap's disease, please let your praise cover it up. What it mean, Dunlap's? Your stomach done lapped over your pain. Says, listen, if you, listen, let your praise cover it up. Don't let your grace and mercy show. You know what I'm saying? Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus.
Yeah. So you, the LA Fitness in Countryside?
It's gonna be something.
Oh, you haven't been to the one yet?
No, I need
you to. You haven't rejoined?
Yeah, I'm gonna have to rejoin.
Okay, all right.
I'm gonna have to reinstate my membership to the church, you know, to the gymnatorium. I walk a lot. I walk as I'm nosing. Now, I will walk from my house to Boston Market, because y'all got some good chicken meat and good spinach. They got some good over there. No, they got some good chicken rotisserie chicken meat over there.
Boston Market?
Let me explain something to you.
Please do, because
I
didn't like it when it was Boston chicken.
So. Listen, they got good chicken meat and they got good spinach meat. I want y'all to know that.
I didn't get an amen from the producer. Well, I don't know if I'm going to have to agree with you.
Let me tell you something. That's called old folk eating. That's what it's called.
The rotisserie is
Yeah, the rotisserie good. Is very good. Yeah. Like Sam's got good rotisserie chicken. But anyway, y'all pray for the pastor.
Please.
Yeah, pray for the pastor. Now, I walk a lot, and I walk, but y'all these old knees and things. Listen, y'all, these old knees.
They 41 years old.
Woo!
They ain't 45 years old.
Let me explain something to y'all. These old knees and things, y'all pray for the pastor.
Okay.
I tried to run track when I was in school, and I played a little football, not on Marge football team, but I played a little football, football, playing football. Mm-hmm. And I believe these old wounds is coming back. Glory, you got to rub your knees. Yeah, praise the Lord. Hallelujah.
So.
Y'all pray for the pastor.
So, as you have taken an observation of what you need with the church, how do you start moving forward with finding those pieces that you need?
We have been on the thing about prayer, period. Mm-hmm. We've been talking about prayer, and I'm meeting with each ministry now to see where they are. I started off to talk about prayer because today in Bible said I'm going to talk about stewardship. But I've been really, really hounding on prayer and having a relationship with God and knowing what to pray for. Because, let me give you this example. In Acts chapter 12, it said that while Peter was in jail, prayer was made continually for him. Not for everybody else, but for him. So here is the sermon about prayer. You need to know the worth of prayer because prayer costs you something. It's worth something.
Come on.
You need to know the words of prayer, what to pray for, and the works of prayer.
Yes, sir.
Because prayer does work if you do it honestly. So we've been doing a lot about prayer and just preaching. And we're going to have to do a lot of teaching. And I and my people perish for the lack of knowledge. And sometimes people say, well, we don't know because we ain't never been taught. No, you didn't show up.
Well, then.
Watch out now.
Well, then. Well.
Yeah. You didn't show up. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking at a new paradigm for church school, instead of calling it Sunday school, church school, and teaching. I am a teacher by profession. That's our people need teaching. Now, let me tell you something. If you teach during the week on Sunday morning, you can go at it.
Right.
You know.
Right.
Because at the end of the day, I want to know I've been to church. Give me food and give me some gravy. So I need
hold the gravy though first.
Yeah, hold the gravy
to the end.
Don't give me gravy now and ain't got no meat.
I wanted to ask you and then it got away from me now because you got that hoop thing that you do.
I try my best. I just holler.
You do it very, very well, and I'm looking for some lessons.
Okay.
Yeah. So now, me myself too.
So right. Can we come out to the second?
Sure.
And you know, you get to organ play. Now I do know this much. My key is D. I've been told.
Okay.
That.
Your key is D. My key is B flat or C.
Okay.
I have absolutely no idea.
Right. So you need to find out what your key is.
He's from the Sanctified Church. They drive us. His head. Come on there. Come on there. See you there. Most sanctified churches are drivers.
Okay.
Are drivers. Baptist preachers are the tuners.
Okay.
What have you.
Okay. So yeah. And,
but can you all sing?
I can hold a note.
Okay. This note right here.
Yeah. Exactly.
You know what?
No. I used to sing with my praise team here. I retired because it's too much work. But no, it's serious. It's just too much going on. Yeah. But no, I can carry. If I get my note, I'm good.
You know what? The only difference between singing and talking is breathing.
Right.
And the only difference between, as I said, tuning and what have you, is breathing and getting your rhythm.
Okay. All right.
That's all.
Okay.
Listen, there's a rhythm to everything.
Right.
Right.
You're going to have to, and find you a comfortable key. And so then it is that God, my Lord, so you're that, hey. Yeah.
See, yes, one of them singers, though.
Right.
Yes, sir.
That's the extra.
Right. Yeah, that's the extra.
Gravy.
That's
the gravy.
But say something and listen to all of my preachers that may be listening.
Come on. Tell them now.
To all of my preachers that may be listening. Don't always try to get to the hoop because I found this out in the country.
Come on.
Good meat make its own gravy.
See there. See there.
Okay. If you cook your meat, you see, first of all, you got to marinate the meat.
That means you
got to study.
Talk, sir. Talk.
You got to study now.
Talk.
You got to study. Don't go on YouTube. Now, listen, it's fine to go on YouTube and get ideas, but don't preach to people sermon word for word.
Ooh. Ooh. Well, then.
Don't do it word for word. You study.
Sermon.com.
Yeah, sermon.com. That's fine.
What?
You know, listen, go on there and look for ideas. Now, listen, because there ain't been nothing that ain't been preached before.
True.
Okay? But now, don't take, here it is.
90 seconds.
Listen, put your salt on there, mix it up, put it out there. But then please, y'all. Don't just get to the hoop. Give me something before then.
Amen.
9 seconds up. Okay.
Look it. We normally do this, but since you're here, could you pray us out, please?
Sure, I can.
God bless you.
Let's pray. God, we thank you now for this time, and I thank you, God, for this opportunity. I ask that you would bless as we're doing the taking the limits off. We pray now, God, that you would bless everyone that comes in, God. And, God, we thank you most of all for being outreach for the community. Help us, God, and all that we do. In Jesus' name we pray. Everybody say amen.
Amen. Hey, look, y'all. It has been an absolutely amazing show. We have had my side hurt. I shouldn't have did abs. I could have skipped the ab part of the workout this morning because he was going.
Skinny people talking. Skinny people talking. Skinny people. The devil is out. Skinny people.
But I appreciate this brother for coming in. God bless you, sir. Thank you for coming out with us. We were definitely going to have him back again. I forgot to ask you what's coming up at First Second Baptist, so that's going to be an excuse.
My installation is coming up the second Sunday in September, the 11th and the 13th.
All right. I'm going to make sure we're going to be there. One of us, somebody going to be there. So, look, we're going to make it a point to talk to this brother. Of course, we're going to get to talk to him after the show. Y'all don't get to hear all that because y'all don't get to get all that good stuff. But, look, we appreciate y'all for listening. We bless y'all. We thank y'all. Everybody good?
Yes,
sir. Everybody's good. All right, look, we out of here, man. I'm going to let y'all finish this here. I need your glory with this William Murphy because he'll sing you crazy. Y'all be blessed now.
Father, can you show me
your power?
I can't go any further.
You've been sweating and you don't
want to. We got wives.
What I need, God. Pastor Murphy, this is what happens to us. Like this right here.
So many times I tried my way.
Oh, yeah.
All of the pain is gone.